company. Had a look, had a hit!
Pourquoi pas Vincent Kompany aussi? Pourquoi pas Vincent Kompany?
Hey everybody, it's Noise Makers Podcast. It's me, Joey McKeon, joined as always by Mark Mulvaney. Alright, Mulv.
What's up, Joseph? How? The transfer window has just slammed shut.
What a day.
Or creeped.
Yeah.
Shut, if you're a Man City fan.
Of all the transfer windows, this was one.
Yeah, it's literally, what, 20 minutes after the, yeah, after the deadline. In fact, actually, we have secret audio of, I guess, Harry Kane is very unhappy with getting his move to Man City. He's currently in the Tottenham boardroom.
Okay.
With Daniel Levy.
Oh, no.
Let me take you to the secret audio.
You're fucking beginner, man.
You bloody bastard bitch.
Ooh, yes.
He sounded angry.
Those two.
They're really going at it.
Yeah.
Fuck you, blondie.
Maybe that was Charlie Kane. I'm not sure. That might have been Charlie.
Man, I'm surprised that we even have the energy to do this show this close to the end of the transfer window with how much went on today. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. Wow. What a snoozer.
Man, oh man. Just
massive snoozer.
I'm partially convinced that like the higher ups at City just didn't show up to work today.
Yeah.
Where they're just like, no. We literally don't have any backup plan. We didn't get the one we wanted. So we're going to go ahead and take a Tuesday off, and we're going to chill. You guys have fun, though. We'll see you.
Did you see my Austin Powers tweet? Where they're at the blackjack table, and he's got like, I don't know what he's got. He's got like seven or something like that, and he says, I'll stay. I also like to live dangerously. Oh, dear. He's our top negotiator.
That's actually cheeky.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
The man himself.
Sexy Bergenstein.
That's the guy. Good Lord. Well, we do have a show to do. We do have a big match that happened last weekend. Well, should have been a big match. Turned out to be one team got the floor wiped with. Mm-hmm. And it is funny. Arsenal went on to become more of a joke, like as the week went on, or as the weekend went on. So like that's pretty good. But we're gonna talk about the City absolute destruction of Arsenal, and then transfer deadline day. We're gonna talk transfers, ones that did happen, ones that didn't happen, ones that should have happened. We'll try to pick the bones of what the hell has or hasn't gone on. So let's not waste any more time. Let's get into this thing right in the meat and potatoes. Vic, take it away.
Meat and potatoes.
City dropped a nickel on Arsenal. 5-0. Just, I mean, it had everything. And when I mean everything, it had everything.
Complete performance.
You had goals from a striker. You had Gabby Jesus on form. You had an Ederson clean sheet. And you had a Granit Xhaka red card. This was everything.
You had an Ederson heart in mouth moment.
Ederson made me say curse words. Yeah, I tweeted out, thanks. Like, shout out Ederson for making me say the fuck word at 7:51 in the morning. Like, I was, so my best friend was in town, like latter part of last week and over the weekend. And that was the first time that I've been out of the house in a while. So, we done did some damage, and let me tell you,
nice one.
This was a nice thing to wake up to and spend my Saturday morning.
I bet, yeah.
Just bleary eyed, big cup of coffee, and just watch the Blue Boys absolutely destroy Arsenal.
In the famous words, where do you go from here?
I don't remember, but we went. Man, oh man, yeah, what a
good
time!
Good for you, pal.
Yeah, it was nice.
It's Good day. No, it was a complete performance. I think we both predicted it could be something like that. Mm-hmm. Maybe not quite as convincing. I do think we ought to pause for a second and just
moment of silence from Mikel Arteta.
Well, that too, yeah. But just drink in the size of these victories, like that we see under Pep Guardiola, and not take them for granted. Like when we say, like when other teams say, you know, they beat somebody convincingly, you're talking about 2-0, 3-0.
Yeah.
Like we are putting 4, 5, 6 past teams and have done so 24 times, I believe, in Pep Guardiola's tenure.
That's some stupid number.
It's just
like
not. It's not normal, mate. It's not normal. And we
I think
need
the
to,
next closest team has like 7.
Yeah, it's single digits.
What?
And it's not high single digits.
No.
No. It is the as promised Guardiola machine, and when it's purring, it will put you 4 or 5 goals down.
Yeah. Sorry, I've just looked at the player ratings. Cedric got
There's a weird one I'm seeing right off the bat.
Cedric
maybe it's
got
only because
Cedric got a 3.
Hmm.
Out of 10.
That's not good.
Jesus. All right. Well, let's go through the lineup real quick, and then we'll talk about everything. Ederson was in goal. We had a back four of Kyle Walker, Ruben Diaz, big Eric Laporte, and Joel Cancelo. I guess only Eric Laporte.
yes. Midfield. He's the only Eric now.
Yeah, he is. He always has been, really, to me, the one true Eric.
Well, of course, yeah.
Midfield, we had Rodri. Yeah, that's right. Was it the doctor of CDMonomics or whatever it is?
Yep.
Gundogan, Bernardo Silva. And then up front, the confusingly good on the day, Gabby Jesus, Ferran Torres, and Jack Grealish. I mean, a lot of stuff's going to go in about the front three, but I mean, it's hard to avoid just how good those guys were when they were on the pitch together. I mean, all three of them were only on the pitch for just about an hour, and it was complete mayhem.
Yeah, there's a lot to talk about in this lineup in terms of performances on the day, pal. Particularly up front, the back wasn't put under too much pressure by Arsenal. They were solid. We forgot to mention it was the same exact side that he put out last week, which I predicted,
Good job, weirdly enough.
And why not, right? Because last week was a stellar performance as well. So just roll the same team out. They all deserved it. So,
do you think if we just keep playing this lineup, we'll win every game 5-0?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's that easy. It's that simple, man.
All right, well, okay. Next topic then. Anyway, transfer deadline day. Crazy what's going on.
Just stick Vincent Kompany statue on the sideline and just roll the same team out every week.
True. Basically the Colossus of Rhodes.
Well done.
Thanks.
Where do you want to start? I don't know. Is there much to say about the back four?
I'm glad Ederson made sure we all had a pulse.
Yeah.
But center backs, fantastic. Cancelo, the man. Kyle Walker, completely unfair. Foot Mob's got him at a 6.7. I don't think he was that bad. I think he came off because we wanted to try playing with a left back for a while.
Similarly, low rating for Bernardo Silva.
Yeah, I think there's. I think there, came off. There has to be a motive here.
There's a bias. If you come off early, you cannot get
you're
above
garbage.
A 7.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, back four, all good. And even Zinchenko when he came on, good. I mean, it's. I don't worry about center backs, like at all anymore. It's just not a position I worry about. There is one position I worry about, which we will get into probably in the transfer deadline thing.
We will,
but because it's not been resolved. But these four are. I mean, it's just guaranteed like a 7+ every time they play. It's amazing.
The front six, mate, we're talking about near perfection. You're talking about KDB injury Bernardo Silva was out there.
Peak.
So you know that's peak Bernardo.
Yep.
You got Godri, who chimed in with a goal. really nice finish.
Felt so good. Feels so good when he scores.
Yeah. That's the only time he can have a non-Gareth Barry-esque game.
True. Well, yeah, and complete performance by him too. Goal and a yellow.
Yeah, yeah, that's a well-rounded CDM performance.
Yeah, yeah. Fernandinho-esque.
Gundogan is up to his old tricks.
He is a scumbag, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah. Just more goals.
Basically, that German Peter Crouch, the dominance in the air.
No, we looked at some of the names that had really stellar seasons last year, and you know, can they repeat that? And Ilkay was one of those, so you wonder. But you know, he's back in the goals again, and his ability to just ghost into the box is unrivaled.
Yeah, he's unreal, especially he doesn't seem to slow down. Even with all the matches he played last year, and we're still leaning on him a lot this year, and he had a busy summer, like, he just doesn't seem to slow down. It's amazing, especially with a guy that when we first showed up, you know, there were some injury issues and blah, 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 like yada, 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 but man, don't quit.
Before we get to the front three, we need to talk about Bernardo for a minute, because this guy was all over the place, mate. I know he came off after 58 minutes, which was a shame, and there was some concern because it looked like he might have been crying when he came off. I don't know if you saw all that.
I saw Twitter trying to break down frames of videos to be like, no, if you see here, there is actually there's perspiration that comes from the eyelid.
Yeah,
it was not indeed a tear.
There was the clapping circle where you clap all four corners of the stadium.
True.
Combined with what was either sweat or tears, not sure. There's a lot of suspicion around whether he was saying goodbye or not. But as we now know, he is here to stay. And I, for one, I'm thrilled with that.
I'm pumped.
I'm having that.
I am all about it.
Yeah,
he's very much kind of like cult hero guy now.
Yes.
I mean, everything about Bernardo changed after the so-called Guard of Honor, where he just couldn't be bothered, and he's out there watching these idiots. Here comes Hendo strolling by, and Bernie's out there with a brew, looking like a hobo. And now we've got edible coffee cups. He's never leaving.
No, I think, you don't know what you've got until it's gone kind of thing.
Yeah.
And he's getting a lot of love right now from the City faithful, which is great. Because he's deserved it the whole time, but the threat of him leaving has been looming for, I think, about a year now. And and it was that threat of him leaving that I think has reminded us all what a top-class player he is. And his performance against Arsenal was just unbelievable, mate. Just he was part of everything. He was carrying the ball from the defense to attack, you know, because Arsenal were playing... Yeah, Arsenal were playing an interesting press that was cutting off a lot of passing lanes. So you needed somebody to drop in and carry the ball forward. He did that really well. Just the intense, pressing and
he's a pest.
Yeah. Yeah, he's just got it all. He's perfect for Guardiola, and I hope he's happy in his life. The rumors are that he wants to leave and what have you. The area. I think he wants to leave the area more than he wants to leave City, but hopefully he's happy, and hopefully we keep winning,
right?
And that will winning cures everything, doesn't it?
It sure can. If we don't have, there's a striker did not come in, and unless young Delap is going to be the everyday guy, I think there's going to be a lot of opportunity for Bernardo to slot in somewhere here, because Kevin will come back at some point, but Bernardo can play, as we all know, either side of the eights. He can play anywhere on the front three. Mm-hmm.
It's perfect. It's perfection.
Dare I say, you could makeshift him over on the left. We could Zinchenko him.
He's not in your left back depth chart, is he?
I think everyone is.
Did you see my Mahrez tweet today?
Yeah. Yeah.
Come here, mate. You're left footed, aren't you?
Yeah. Well, that's where Pep has it wrong.
Yes. Yeah.
It's a right footed player. These are all facts. Right.
I just wanted to throw some love at Bernardo because
yeah.
the kid's immense. All right, the front three, mate. Gabriel Jesus on the right wing is a revelation.
Is he actually just the best right winger that's ever existed?
Quite possibly.
I mean, last two games, we're looking at, I think, 3 assists and a goal.
Yeah. Steve Kinsey-esque levels.
I mean, that's under... yeah, it's true. That's exactly it's
that's,
exactly
that's
the same.
Before your time, pal.
That is an old one. That's... The shorts are...
Nicky Summerby-esque? Is that
yeah,
old?
Yeah, more? I got
Okay.
Yeah, the shorts are very short when you go to start hitting up Kinsey and...
It's true.
Some of those other... It was Paul Power? Was he back
Paul
then?
Power. He's more of a midfielder, but yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
That was back then with the...
Oh, that was short.
He of the short shorts, yeah. Mm-hmm. You had to have... you had to have the right grunders for that.
Yeah.
That era.
Thighs out poorly, I think is what they called him.
Like that. I might steal that. You know, short shorts are like a thing right now.
Yeah.
And I might just dive all in on it.
Have you it.
Know? Yeah. Skies out, thighs inch, out.
6-inch inseam, mate's what you're looking for.
Yeah, I go 7 right now, but that's because I got a
okay.
thick caboose on me. Yeah. But yeah, I think Gabby on the wing is just delightful to watch, especially when you've got some...
That bunda stew.
Truth. That is true. People say that about me.
They do. Thick boy.
Yeah, hell yeah. Yeah, Gabby on the wing, especially up against that bum Kieran Tierney.
Mm-hmm.
And Kolasinac, who had no business being out there. I mean,
washed.
It was just
dusted player.
Oh my god, it wasn't fair. Gabby is. If we can get, what are there 38 games in a season? If we can get 20 performances like that out of Gabby in the Premier League, see you. Goodbye. You cannot touch us.
On the other wing, it was carves out Jackie.
Oh. No goals. Got an assist.
Yeah, didn't... I don't know. Found the ball going down the right side, I think, more often in this game. Yeah. I don't know if they were... If Arsenal were like double-teaming Jack or what they were doing, but... yeah, he didn't have as much of the ball as you would have liked, but he did have a very impressive assist to Jesus, where he makes, I think, something that maybe Sterling is... still working on at the moment, and that is the final ball. Once he does get into the box, he's doing the getting into the box part right, but Grealish does something that Raheem's missing at the moment, and that's finding a player that will put the ball in the back of the net. So
yeah,
love to see that. He's yeah still electric for me when he's on the ball. I still get a buzz when he's on it. That's my type of winger.
I think they were doubling over there because Saka was on that side, I think. Yeah, Saka and Cedric. And at this point, like looking at that player rating, I'm wondering if Cedric was there just at all.
Right.
Because I think you walk on the pitch with a six. Dude, he had a low.
That's like the basic number, yeah.
Granit Xhaka's got a 5.2, and that fool got sent off.
Wow. So the sent off player
had better
rating
than
Cedric.
Everyone on the back line. Cedric, 3.0. Callum Chambers, 4.8. Rob, barely holding on to his hair, 4.9. Kolasinac, 4.5. And Tierney, 4.7.
Huh.
Damning.
Interesting.
But yeah, Jack.
So
Jack yeah. and Gabby, about Great. That. Big time wing fan over here. Now there's a small case of a gentleman that was playing through the middle.
Who is this guy?
Striker. It's actually Fernando Torres. We created we have a time machine. We clone people. So we have cloned Ronaldo. We've put Gabby Jesus on his back and he's on the wing now for us. And
Love
then
it.
we went back in time and got Fernando Torres and says like, oh, I think this could be the guy. Well, what do we do? Everyone's gonna know it's Fernando Torres. No. Change his name to Ferran. That'll do it. Ferran Torres.
Yeah, this is Liverpool Fernando Torres.
100%.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. So let's talk about him for a minute. So we've always obviously not signed a striker this summer.
What?
So I'm guessing the vibes from City on this guy must be really, really high.
Has to be.
And I suppose they're just, I mean, they've switched Jesus out to the wing and they've brought Torres inside. So they must be looking at him and going, this guy is clinical. And, you know, I think on the evidence we've seen so far, hasn't played that much, but does appear to be our most clinical finisher.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, if you can turn this guy into, you know, Fernando Torres, what did we pay for this guy? 25 million?
Not even? Yeah, whatever. Yeah. It was good to want numbers. It was down there.
It could end up being really, really good business. He looks so talented, the runs he's making, and he's added, this game in particular, added other dimensions to his play in that he can look quite anonymous in the nine. But to be fair, as do a lot of the nines that we've tried that aren't Sergio Aguero, right?
Yeah.
It seems that everybody but Sergio can look quite anonymous in that position. But to his credit, he started dropping into the midfield and being part of the build-up, and he's making intelligent runs. So I thought it was a more mature number nine performance from Ferran Torres, and just really, really exciting. And, you know, when we start talking about the transfer window and what we're left with, you know, he'd be one for the, you know, optimistic column, you know?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, if we can get 15 goals out of him for the season... That's a win.
Absolutely.
You know, if you can get 15 out of him, you know more are going to come from everywhere around him. But if you can get 15 out of him, because you're trying to replace guys like Aguero that it was 20 plus every season.
Right.
It's like, okay, so if we can get 15.
Yeah,
Gabby will get some. Jack will get some. Sterling will get some. Mahrez, Silva, Rodri, Gundogan, Kev. At some point, the Towers... at the back, we'll start getting some because,
yeah, true.
You know, they just, that's their thing now. They must see, the club must see something in him for, they either see something in him or they're so convinced that they have something lined up for January or next summer.
Right.
They're like, you know what? Fuck it. We'll roll the dice. We'll go with Torres and I guess Delap and whoever else we decide to throw up there. But yeah, more of this, please.
Yeah. So two goals and an assist for Ferran Torres.
Yep.
Would you say he was the man of the match?
I kind of think Gabby was.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. Torres was really, really good, but I think Gabby was a menace. But, you know, he came off after 61 minutes, so I guess it's tougher to be like,
yeah, true.
Didn't play the whole 90. Can he win it?
I'm going to give it to Ferran Torres just for the output, but I'm going to... make a case for Bernardo Silva.
Yeah.
I mean, I already sort of did.
Yeah.
He was crucial and he was everything. He got us. When City score first, it's almost inevitable, you know, that we'll win.
True.
When we score first and we score early like that and we're at home, I just felt like from the off, Bernardo Silva sort of led by example and got us up, got us ahead. And we never looked back. So I don't want to discount how important he was. And I'm just really thrilled that he's going to be staying.
Yeah, I'm pumped about that. Yeah, hell yeah.
So where does that leave us, mate, in the league and that?
Tough times for the club in crisis that is Manchester City. Even after spending all of that money, City are currently in seventh place outside of the European spots. Even outside of
that league?
The European... Milk Cup .com conference league or something. We're outside of that even. But
the Manscaped Cup.
Yeah. The Mono's Wine Conference League.
Thank you, Mono's Wine. Wow, that's a throwback.
Yeah, there you go. That's for the OGs. Mm-hmm. So City are in seventh on 6 points. goal difference of nine. We've scored 10, allowed one. So good job to you, Leicester. Running down the league, though, we've got Spurs up in front in first place, undefeated, three wins.
Have not conceded, points. It looks like.
Have not conceded.
Three goals, none conceded.
They level 1-0 them. West Ham, big spenders West Ham, who spent, I think, somewhere close to like $70 million today, are in second on 7 points. United, who definitely aren't getting rinsed for cash right now, third on 7 points. Chelsea, who are definitely going to win this whole thing with what they've done today, in fourth on 7 points. And then Liverpool in fifth on 7 points. Everton in sixth on 7 points.
Okay.
So a lot of even goal difference there.
Things international like break. We're three games in. We're still in this. We're only 3 points off the top. A loss and two comprehensive wins. I'm feeling pretty decent.
Yeah, I mean, we're not going to get relegated or anything, but you know, we'll finish in the Champions League spots and all that. But I am genuinely worried about Chelsea.
About the title. Yeah. Understood. Yeah. Well,
I think that's it, man. That's the Arsenal thing. Let's take a break. When we get back, I mean, it's everyone's 1 or 1A favorite thing to talk about. It's either kits or transfers. We're going to talk transfer deadline day. Don't move. Who's buying
Newtopia? Hi, everyone. This is Michelle with Houston Space Citizens, the official Manchester City Supporters Club in Houston, Texas. You can come and watch City with us every weekend at the Phoenix on Westheimer. And you can also get in touch with us on Instagram and Twitter at Houston Citizens and Facebook at Houston Space Citizens.
Johnny Marr, you're listening to the Noisy Neighbours podcast.
There we go. That's our real life best friend, Johnny Marr.
Big news coming out of the Johnny Marr camp.
Yeah, he's dropping albums.
He dropped a new single today called Spirit, Power and Soul off his new, what I think is an EP called Fever Dreams Part 1 that comes
guitar
out
in with
October.
Nine pickups is what I saw.
Yeah,
I don't know what that does. I don't know music things, but that seems like a lot.
Yeah, in phase, out of phase, the lot. It does the lot.
It does it all, huh?
Yes, it does. But yeah, so I did a little bit of research on this, and it looks like research.
Thank you.
As we say in England. Sorry.
There you go.
I'm all twisted up. Looks like it may be an EP.
Okay.
The first. Thing to drop in October, and then maybe three more after that.
So he was very bored.
Yeah.
In quarantine.
He was.
Our man's went to the mountains and was like, well, I guess we'll just drop bangers. Also, mate, take notice, Kanye, dude. You lock yourself in a stadium and release some bum album. Meanwhile, our friend, our best friend in real life, and he'll even tell you that, went out to the Dadgum Mountains, middle of by God nowhere in England, and just cranked out tunes with a guitar from the future.
That's right. One of my favorite stories was the time we had him on remotely.
Same.
Right?
Oh.
And we told him he had to record his own audio, right? So he's got a MacBook and an iPhone, right? And I said, okay, well, you're going to have to listen to us on your MacBook and record your voice on your iPhone.
Uh-huh.
And then send it to us, right? And yeah. He goes, okay, well, I'm not sure, lads, if I've got enough room on my iPhone to record my voice, so let me just go through some things here and sort of, you know, get rid of some of these things. So he's going through his, he's flipping through his phone and he's going, okay, yeah, riff in D, yeah, I could delete that. He goes, yeah, chorus, pre-chorus, right, delete, right? Like, this man was literally deleting, like, his next album or, like, the next, you know, I don't know, what difference does it make of the next, you know, possibly deleted half of his repertoire to record a stupid podcast with us. That was funny. Anyways, but also... Yeah, so big shout, Johnny, and congratulations on a new album. But also big shout to the Houston Space Citizens who who are new on the plug circuit.
On the official scene.
We like to plug the branches of the Supporters Club. And hopefully those listening, if you live in that area, you can go out and watch City with them. So that's Houston Space Citizens, Michelle Shepherd, and her mates down there in Houston.
Yeah,
so
and
if you're in there.
If you're in a group and you haven't heard of, if you haven't heard your group on the show, or if you're living in an area and you're not sure if there is one, get in touch. Mm-hmm. Because if you're a group and you need a little bit of pub, let us know. Send us a, we'll send you what to say. Just send us the audio clip and we'll get it on the show because
magic.
The more the merrier.
That's right.
Well, transfer window is closed. Ooh. City have done, they got Jack Grealish.
Yeah.
That was very good. That's a big thing to do.
Massive.
Unfortunately, not exactly, what we were looking for in the window so much. Not Harry Kane, Alfie Haaland.
Alfie
Haaland. I'll take Alfie Haaland back now.
Yeah, can he play left back?
Erling Haaland, sorry. God.
We're going to have a lot of Alfie Haaland and Rory DeLapp, I think, happening on this show.
I'm worried about it. I almost already called him Rory DeLapp. Hey, if Liam can bomb a ball, let's go. If he can throw it 40 yards, I'm down. We didn't get a striker. We didn't get a left back, which we've needed for a long time, and we need even more now, apparently. It's just, it feels like, I'm trying to figure out how to say this, but there's not a clean way to do it.
Oh dear.
This feels like,
do I need a dump button?
I don't know. I think I can do it. It feels like we've been, chatting to a girl for a long time and we finally like got some alone time and all that kind of stuff. And it's just, it's over before it started. You're just going home. You got to change your pants. And the rest of the time you just have to explain, you're just explaining like, no, this isn't, that's not normally what happens. Like we're really,
I
normally,
swear this never happens.
I'm actually super cool. I'm so cool. Please know how cool I am. Look at all these friends I have. I do have friends. They couldn't come tonight, but I have friends and that's what City did. We got the big one out of the way at the beginning. And then the rest of the time we just sat there begging for another chance and it never came.
I will admit to being quite torn over what's happened this summer and what hasn't happened, mate, in that I'll take the positive side first, right? In that if you look at it on paper, it's a title winning side plus Jack Grealish, right? Mm-hmm. Cause let's be fair, Aguero didn't feature much last season. So although he's gone, isn't making that much of a difference to the squad. So, Premier League winner, Carabao Cup winner, Champions League finalist, FA Cup semi-finalist side, plus Jack Grealish. Okay, mm-hmm. So you could say a strengthened side. But that's on paper, right?
Yeah.
So if we're going to look at things on paper, we have to look at the rest of the league on paper.
Do and not want to do league... this exercise.
Yeah, the rest of the league on paper have done a lot more than we have. Now, granted, we did win the league quite comfortably. I'm pretty sure it was by double digits. So there is some ground for the other teams to make up, but it would appear on paper that Chelsea look imperious.
Yeah,
United have strengthened.
That Saul Niguez deal just went across the line. They got
it. I'm sorry, who?
Saul Niguez. They got it in. What's wrong?
Nothing.
You seem weird.
No, I'm good. I'm good.
Would you prefer if I just called him Saul?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Thank
you. Got you down as a name shamer. So Mark is very anti-Niguez.
Wow. See, I'm glad he went there because that name was definitely getting us canceled, mate.
For sure. So now we get to say it all year. So he's at Chelsea now, and they've got Lukaku. All they did was get so much better.
Yep.
And
so on paper,
it's
Liverpool
yep.
are better because they are healthy as of now they are healthy. Are they deeper? Not particularly. They're about the same, but chances are they will be healthier this year.
Firmino out for months.
Firmino's out?
Mm.
Oh, I didn't know.
Potentially
okay,
3 months. That just came out like yesterday.
Okay. Yeah, see, they could be in trouble if they get injuries like they did last season.
Yep.
But I'm saying, across the top there, United, Chelsea, on paper, stronger. Liverpool, mm-hmm. about the same, except they'll be healthier. Okay. So, yeah, I'm a little bit, even when you just look at it like that, I'm thinking, okay, the gap has closed, in my opinion, right?
Yep.
And then when you think about just the cycle and what I think City intended to do, which mm-hmm. was, I think all intentions were to refresh the side. Because I think, as we know in sports, it's hard to ride the same horse to victory over and over again.
Yep.
The horse just gets burned out, yeah?
Well, all the best managers even say, like, every 3 years you need to turn over a decent amount of your team.
Yep. And I realized that the market made it difficult for us to do that. But by all accounts, the targets we had and went for, we know we went for these players.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of Jack Grealish, we didn't get him. And our two main, I think, weaknesses were at striker and mm-hmm. at fullback, particularly left back, I think. Although I want to talk about right back a bit in a minute here.
Okay.
And we had massive misses on both. Massive. Yeah. Like we weren't even close to getting Harry Kane. And we had all our eggs in that basket. It was Kane or bust. And while... I don't know. Maybe there's a quality of striker that, unless you can get that quality, then you just go with, well, I think Ferran Torres could be my striker, right? Or Delap, or a combination of the two.
Mm-hmm.
But it was so strange for us to miss the Kane deal so massively in that Levy wasn't even going to talk to us. Like, we didn't even put in an offer to get him to pick up the phone. You know?
Yeah, we were a third off of what he wanted.
Yeah. As far as I know, we were 75 plus 25, right? Yeah,
so more than a third.
Yeah, and he was apparently at 150, just to even answer us, you know?
Right.
So how did we miss that so poorly? That baffles me, because I in one regard I feel like our owners are quite smart and our leadership team is quite smart. However, they have dropped some massive clangers over the last 6 months or so that really got my head scratching.
And I've seen people say, like, well, you know, the club has evaluation of players and they won't go above that evaluation and all that kind of stuff. And it's like, all right, well, hear me out here. What if our valuation's wrong? What if our valuation on players isn't what the market is? And if that's the case, you're always going to miss out on these players because you're not going to spend the money. And it's tough for me to believe that we did value. Well, we thought Jack Grealish was enough value to go and hit his release clause at 100 million. But Harry Kane, who, like you said, we put all of our eggs in that basket. Almost guaranteed goals at City. I mean, barring a catastrophic injury, guaranteed.
The opinion out there across all of the pundits was, if City signed Harry Kane, the league was over. Like, it was a mm-hmm. chance for City to mm-hmm. put their foot on the throat of the rest of the league and pretty much guarantee winning it at a canter.
Right.
So the fact that we were so far off Levy's valuation just baffling.
And I don't think, at the beginning of all this, I thought Levy was a little bit crazy for asking that kind of money. But then I see Lukaku went for mm-hmm. just shy of 100.
Yep.
So it's like, all right, well, I can see, because you have to add the homegrown tax. I can see why we're nosing up to 150. You know, if Grealish is 100,
mm-hmm.
Harry Kane's more complete product than Grealish is, and he's in the prime of his career. You know, it's just, I don't know. I don't. Who was it? Was it Stefan and like the 93/20 boys did like a Twitter? It's called Spaces.
Twitter Spaces, yeah.
They did one last week, and
Was that the one that he called my name or our yeah. name? And,
yeah.
And like, I wasn't really ready to speak, but because he said our name, I thought, oh, shit, I better jump on it.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, they were talking about it a bunch, too, and I wanted to talk to you about it. My question to them was, why the hell does it always seem like, well, there is no plan B? Mm-hmm. It seems like we don't figure out a plan B, C, or D until we've dragged plan A all the way to the end of the window.
Yeah.
And not because things were close. We've dragged plan A to the end of the window because we keep trying to, like, inch our way up a ladder. And the other team is just sitting there like, "What? No, we're not doing this." And City just like, "Well, yeah. we're confident. We think that this is going to be." And if they literally told you, do not be confident about this. Don't. Why are we doing this? Yeah, I don't get it. I don't know if you have anything to say. I'm like, what do you think the deal is with us never having a backup plan?
I wouldn't say never in that the Ruben Diaz, I think, is a good example of us having, you know, A, B, C options. And like,
once A got to August 25th.
Yes, it was late. It was very late. But there was an option and he's turned out brilliantly. True. And that is part of why you have to sort of temper, you know, your frustration in that all the evidence we have is that the transfer policy of this club has yielded trophy upon trophy, mm-hmm. right? Now, let me ask you a quick question. Do you think that we've earned trophy upon trophy in spite of our transfer policy, or do you think that our transfer policy has contributed to the trophies? Because I can see where somebody might say, well, actually, I don't think our transfers have been that great, but Pep Guardiola is just an absolute magician, and he's gotten trophies out of it. So where do you stand on that?
I think it's a season-to-season thing, but, I mean, if one of the easiest ones to pull up is, like, a time where our transfer policy 100% let us down was the Pellegrini was here, and we had just won the league, and we didn't sign anybody, I don't think.
Yeah, he signed. He signed Fernand. No, you're right.
I don't think we signed anyone. Yeah, we just into the next season, like loaned out a few guys, and I think sold somebody. And the transfer policy there was either the higher ups at the club didn't think we needed anybody, or they didn't value anybody in the market enough to think that someone could help us out. As if our squad was perfect. And those Pellegrini years, those squads were not perfect by a long shot. There were definite holes in there. Mm-hmm. I think Pep, obviously, because he's the best on the planet, gets a lot more out of players than other managers mm-hmm. would. Perfect example, and it's a cheap shot, kind of, but you look at what United has, even before Ronaldo showed back up. They've spent under Ole like nosing up to £450 million on players.
Yeah. Yeah.
With nothing to show for it. And
I like it.
Yeah. And I think that's just the difference in the managers is that I think sometimes maybe our boardroom staff gets a little protected by the fact that they have the best that's ever done it.
Yeah, he covers up a lot of
look at the left back situation. Of issues. Look at the left back situation, and that's not even Pep. That's Pep. That's, Pellegrini had Clichy and Kolarov, mm-hmm. and they were both good, but neither one of them were best in the league. Most years, probably not top three in the league. Since Pep's been there, he's had to convert midfielders to left backs. And the one that we did buy got broken and then was a very, very bad boy, apparently.
Yeah.
And then that's a whole thing, too, about what's going on with that. But I don't know what our transfer policy is, to be quite honest with you.
The thing about transfer windows is that you can't truly measure them for a year at minimum, right? You can speculate about whether you've had a good transfer window, whether you've won the transfer window, which a lot of people rate transfer windows over trophies, which bugs the shit out of me.
Looking at you, Spurs.
They are trophies for some people. But you can't really judge them until you're down the road a little bit. But so, I I'm torn. I'm enthused and confident in, you know, the decisions of Guardiola and his leadership team. They have yielded trophies in the past. One time we won the league with 100 points. We came back with only Riyad Mahrez added and did 98 points and won it again, which has sort of vibes of this yeah. transfer window, right? You win the league, you add a forward, a really good forward, and you know, maybe you win it again. So, yeah, I think for...
The difference there was Aguero.
Yeah, yeah, true. He was massive.
The difference is we didn't lose the best striker the league's ever seen.
Great point. Yeah. So, I don't know, mate. I am worried. But I tell you what. Let me tell you what I'm worried about more than the striker. Actually, do you want to take a break and then...
Yeah, just as the transfer window closed, massive deal has gone through that is gonna shake up probably all of England. And I'm not bullshitting you here.
Benjani.
No.
Mido. Steve Malbrank.
Josh Murphy has signed for Preston North End on loan from Cardiff City.
I knew it was a bit, you bastard.
All right, yeah, let's take a break and then we'll come back and do more things. Don't move.
To find your nearest official Supporters Club branch, get on the Tinternet and go to supportersclubs.mancity.com. There are over 300 branches across the globe, supported by Manchester City and each other. It's a great way to meet your fellow City supporters wherever you are in the world. Player, give me some brew and I might just chill. But I'm the type that likes to light another joint like Cypress Hill. I still do be spit loogies when I puff on it. I got some bucks on it, but it ain't enough on it. Go get the STIDES. Nevertheless, I'm hella fresh, rolling joints like a cigarette. So pass it across the Welcome back to the Noisy Neighbors podcast. It's Mark Mulve and Joey McCune.
Hello.
Joey McCune, host of Noisy Neighbor Man City.
That's me,
and that is Loonies by request.
Yeah, that's a jam.
That is a bop.
I get down to that.
Which is funny because you know that all the drops of this is Joey McCune, Nosy Neighbors. The music behind all that is that
it's,
song.
Yeah, yeah. It's because the bit they do is called "I Got Five on It." I'm pretty sure.
That's right. That's right. Anyway, yeah, 5-0 thrashing of Arsenal. So there you go.
Something stinks in Spain.
Uh oh.
Sky Sports Bring news reporter me. Keith Lay Downey. This is from Keith Downey at Sky Sports. I'm being told the Spanish online registration system is temporarily down, hence why there's a holdup in a couple of Spanish deals involving Saúl Ñíguez to Chelsea and Helder Costa to Valencia. As long as they were submitted in time, they should go through. You tell me the Burrow facts don't work again. Scumbags, dude. I don't like Spain. Spain might be creeping up there to be more crooked than Italy. Real Madrid's got money now.
How?
I thought you said you didn't have none, and that's why we had to do a Super League.
Right. Dodgy AF, bro.
I don't like it. Anyway, what are we doing here? Let's keep doing this.
Let's keep talking about transfers, mate. And okay. I teased this segment by saying that the thing I was worried about more than not getting a striker was, you know, we had the breaking news, disturbing news about Ben Mendy.
Mm-hmm.
So we're down a left back. And I saw somebody tweet this, and it dawned on me when I read the tweet. What if Cancelo or Walker get injured?
Yeah.
We're very focused on left back, right?
Mm-hmm.
And not having a proper one, other than I would argue Zinchenko is now a proper left back, a Pep left back, but a proper left back. But I got to thinking, I don't know that left back is a bigger problem as right back, in that if you lose your left back, if you lose Zinchenko or Cancelo, you could, in a pinch, use an Ake, use a Laporte, something like that, right? Left footers.
Mm-hmm.
If you lose one of the right backs, what is the depth looking like on that side? Like, you know, if Walker goes out, right? Well, then you've got
I think all this comes back to the issue of left back. The fact that our other right left back is the right back.
Yes.
This is the issue. It all goes back to we needed a left back.
Mm.
Because if you're not having to use one of your right backs as the best left back, you can rotate them on the right and you don't run into these problems.
Okay, so let's say Cancelo gets injured.
Okay.
Then you've only got one right back, yeah?
Yep.
You've got nobody backing up there that you think of, like maybe Stones?
Dino?
But but you're really stretching at that point. So
put him in the middle. You would just play him inverted and he wouldn't have to run a ton.
Just play three?
No, play how Cancelo like cuts inside?
Yeah, just the Cancelo role.
Then you just end up with Rodri and Fernandinho in the middle. That's fine.
Once again, Pep Guardiola having a masterclass it to make things work. Let's just say fullback, mate.
Yeah.
Worries me more than striker. You've got a lot of things you could do at number nine. Torres looks great. Dilap, I would love to see, certainly in the cup games.
Mm-hmm.
But an injury to a right back is problematic for me.
I think the fact that we went into this season at all with one left back that we can trust is criminal.
Well, I'm going to tread lightly around the whole Mendy thing, mate, but the club knew.
No, I'm just saying we had one left back we could trust. Take what Mendy did out of it.
Yeah.
We had one left back we could trust, and it was Zinchenko. Okay.
If you just look at it from a playing perspective,
we had one guy we could trust.
Yeah,
it was Zinchenko. Otherwise, we knew we were going to have to play a center back over there, and the club didn't do shit about it.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, you've got Spurs went and got Emerson to play right back from Barcelona, who was supposed to have like a 300 million euro buyout clause, and they got him for 30.
Wow.
PSG went and got the dude that everybody said that City was going to buy, and City didn't want to pay the money.
On loan.
So
yeah.
Instead, PSG said, well, what if we do a loan first, and then we'll pay you later? As if City couldn't do that? I don't know. Left back's been a problem for 5 years, and we haven't done shit about it, and it's unacceptable at this point.
So we're in agreement that more bothered by not having a left back than a striker.
Yeah, I mean, it is annoying that you know there's strikers out there that could have been bought, like Will Grigg signed for Rotherham United today, and there's just
still on fire.
He's sitting on a couch in this video, so I don't think so. I think he's cooled off.
Southend are terrified.
True. Yeah, they're very nervous.
I don't know if they're in the same league. That was a wild guess.
That's probably close. I tell you what, the Palace did a good job getting a striker. They got Edouard from Celtic.
Mm.
He is, I'm telling you right now, 15 goals for Palace this season.
Okay, Edouard.
He is a freak. Yeah, he is a freak.
What's the story? Is that a Brazilian name? What is that?
No, he's French.
Oh, okay.
I forget what his first name is, but his last name's Edouard. He's a monster, though. But, it's... And I think they got him for cheap. And it's Odson Edouard. That's what it is. £14 million.
Odson.
Yeah. Don't know.
It's a new one for me. Odson.
Yeah. Well, you're not French. So. it's just. You see deals happening out there where we could have done something. You're not going to get Harry Kane. Fine. Let's get someone that is that's proven. I don't care. Get somebody.
Okay, so we haven't even touched on the Ronaldo fiasco. Where were you on that?
Get fucked.
Yes.
he's a prick. He is as united as they come. He's got his own things. Like say goodbye to doing a US tour if he's on the team.
Yeah.
Because guess what? He ain't allowed here. He's a bad boy. Scumbag, bad person, scores lots of goals, but that's not enough for me to think he's not a complete piece of shit. And I think the last thing that City needs is somebody that makes everything about him.
Yeah.
And he doesn't know how to do anything other than that. The fact that he has like a trademarked celebration tells you all you need to know. That he just can't, there's nothing organic about the man. He can't celebrate organically. It has to be this planned out 1, 2, 3 steps, jump, turn, hands down, two, and then everybody does it. You know, like, I'm sick of it.
I love it.
Get fucked.
Okay, good, good. No sitting on the fence.
Sit there.
Yeah, proper Burting on the Noisy Pod can't from Joey McCune. Oh, go on, one more time, mate.
Joey McCune, host of Nosy Neighbor Man City.
That's right.
That's me. Hello.
That's right. Yeah, I did a live stream on Friday where I confessed to getting sucked in by the hype for just a short period. And then the City faithful on Twitter rescued me from my poor judgment. So, yeah, I was suing with the lads from City Extra there for a while. And then I stopped suing when I found out that he should probably be in jail.
They were doing it too?
Oh, mate, they were suing. They were suing so much, everyone, so hard.
A lot of short memories going around here.
There was desperation in the air, pal. There was desperation because if you remember the timing of it was pretty much right on the heels of us walking away from the Kane deal or him walking away from us, whatever. And there was mad desperation in the air. And, you know, all the news was that he was, you know, he was coming. And
the only good thing that could have come from it would be banter.
Yeah,
everything else would have felt disgusting.
Because
every time he scored, you'd be like, this fucking guy.
Now, you know? If I was in a pub full of rags, I would be suing all over the place.
Also, how funny that, like, the reason that they ended up spending the cash on him is because they spazzed out.
Yeah.
That, like, as a brand, we cannot allow this to happen.
That, I mean, that's a film in and of itself, mate. That all the,
that's
the,
draft
the
day.
Yeah, that's dealings. Oh, man, I would love to know.
The Glazers trying to figure out, like, well, if we do this, how much money can we take out of the club at the end of the season still? We still have to take our money, please.
I think what it does highlight, though, is that, and maybe this is a good thing based on all of the rumors coming out of UEFA, are that the new FFP regulations are going to be around wages and wage limits and potential luxury taxes, stuff like that, yeah? And one thing is evident with City in walking away from some of the deals we walk away from is that we do not break our wage structure. We
True.
Will not break it. Like,
true.
And you look at some of the teams that have got themselves into massive, massive trouble. They have not given a shit about their wage structure. And now
like
they're
who?
In yeah, you know, Barcelona.
What?
Yeah.
Barcelona. With that front three, Memphis Depay, Martin Braithwaite, and Luke de Jong, you think that came because they had a bad wage structure and they had to do some weird business? You mean to tell me taking an 80 million euro loss on one player is bad business?
Wow.
Eesh.
Eesh. He's got some baggage as well, doesn't he?
Grease bag?
Anyway. Griezmann?
Oh, Anton Griezmann.
Yes, that time he was playing for the Harlem Globetrotters. Yeah. Anyways, they know what I'm talking about.
The Globetrotters do.
Yeah. So, yeah, City will not break their wage structure. And, you know, maybe that will serve us in the long run, mate. Like I said, the FFP regs, the new ones, are apparently all about wages. So,
are they?
Maybe that. It's supposed to be.
It's all made up. It's all made up. None of the rules matter.
I know it's not particularly tangible, but I think you can keep a dressing room together when there is equity in wage structure, yeah? When you don't have one or two guys just making massively more than everybody else, and there's a good, sensible structure to how much everybody makes in the side, depending on their age and their performance and what have you, and their position. So this, I know it's not tangible, and it's hard to try to convince somebody who's livid about the transfer window that you have to keep an eye on wages.
Yeah,
you know. So speaking of which, would you like to take to the streets of Twitter?
Yeah,
for just a minute. It's a very mixed bag, I'll tell you that, mate. I asked for some questions.
Just quickly, I do think we could have maintained the wage structure and signed a left back, a striker.
I totally agree.
Why we haven't done that.
So I don't think we walked away from, say, Kane or a left back on a wage thing. I think we walked away from probably Messi and Ronaldo.
Yeah, which I get that.
For those reasons.
I get that.
Same. And we should, you know, we're running out of time on this pod, but we need to talk about whether...
International break, baby.
Yeah, we got a break coming up. The question of, you know, did we hold out for Kane and therefore miss out on Messi, or what happened there? Do we feel like we missed out on Messi because we were holding out for Kane, or what? Let's do that for another podcast.
Let's do that next week. Yeah.
Okay, so from Twitter, mate, Connor says, we didn't land any big ones, but the squad is still world-class and full of very likable players, so I'm quite happy. Definitely a dig at Cristiano there.
You don't think Ronaldo is likable?
Well, wow. and maybe big up Bernardo because he's very likable.
He is the
and
man.
We've kept him. So, nice one, Connor. Thanks, mate. Mark Kohlberg, tranquilo. He says,
that
love
makes
it.
One of us.
Torres will do the job up front, and Laporte/Ake are upgrades over Mendy at left back. IMO. Okay, Mark. Nice
Ake.
One. Yeah.
I'd love to be with you, but
he's
on
the depth chart, but he's way down for me.
Oh man, Falcao has left Galatasaray and has joined Rayo Vallecano.
What's his name?
Radamel Falcao.
How do you say his last name?
Falcao.
Oh, come on, mate. He used to do Falcao.
Falcao.
Yeah, like
remember
Carabao.
Remember that loan?
Yeah.
United?
Yeah.
Man, they love getting just dicked out of money on a striker, don't they? Holy cow. Anyway, continue. Yes.
Another, you know, when I said that, you know, sometimes you have to wait a year to see whether a transfer window has been successful. I mean, United, that when they have gone in for a player because City were in for a player, it has not worked out. And
Shout
we
out.
Have enough time.
Shout out, Alexis.
Yeah. Enough time between then and now to officially rule on that. So,
yeah.
Matthew Sheehorn. Not upset, to be honest. This creates opportunity for Torres to shine. Cancelo can play left or right back, trusting Pep and the front office. And then he puts hashtag shark team.
I think that one's got to get buried.
I think that's got to die.
We have to burn that. We have to burn that.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's three quite positive tweets so far.
Okay.
Let me find somebody who's...
I do feel like there's going to be a negative turn here.
Yeah.
Because what time is it? Yeah, because when you sent that out, it was probably around 11 o'clock or midnight in the UK. They were up. Jeez.
Okay, Steve Fontana.
Okay.
He tends to be... Sorry, Steve. I find you quite reactionary, mate. No hard feelings. Me trying to be okay with doing next to nothing... F.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, he's not happy. Typical Steve.
Yep. Yeah. It is. I know it takes. You have to fucking wait for everything to pan out and everything, but it is going to grind my gears even more. Especially now with we can get into the Mendy thing next week too. But like, we knew we couldn't trust him on the field, mm-hmm. and then for the past like few months. We've known that there's bigger issues around, and not only do we keep playing him, we didn't suspend him, and then we didn't do shit to fix the position. It's just, it's shit like that where I'm like, maybe the board isn't that great.
Well, this is me, and I did a half in jest Twitter tweet.
Okay, that's
I did a Twitter tweet.
Okay, boomer.
Suggesting that City have been unserious since we agreed to a European Super League that was written on the back of a hotel football napkin.
Yeah.
So to compound that, right, because I think that was quite ridiculous. That was such a half-baked idea by all accounts, and we signed up for that. I've got doubts about the leadership there. I've got doubts about the leadership when it comes to the Champions League final. Mm-hmm. And I've got doubts about the Mendy situation. Worst of all, that we didn't sign a replacement, knowing all that was going on. Yep. I understand they probably have some legal reasons for doing what they did or whatever. I don't really know the ins and outs of that. But to to not even bring in somebody else is
wild behavior.
Yeah, it's unserious, as that term is going around quite a bit. So, yeah, a bit. Again, I regard the leadership of the club. They've done us well over the last decade or so since they took over. You cannot argue with the results, but there's a couple of real head scratches over the last 6 months that poor.
Yeah.
Anyway, so let's get into Christopher with a K. Mm-hmm. Very nice. Personally, I'd feel a lot better about our chances if we had a few dozen more wingers.
True.
So he's going with the sarcasm.
He thinks he's cute.
Yeah, I think he is. I think this bloke is underneath a desk in the fetal position, trying sarcasm to fight through
his coping mechanism. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And lastly, let's do a couple more. Why not? We've got an international break, so
true.
Let's go. John Peck is not having it. John Peck out of Austin. Shambolic, in my opinion. Every season needs another few players to refresh the squad, and Grealish alone is not enough to do that. It seems that Cheeky basically tucked tail and trudged home. This is vivid. He elicits vivid words.
Yeah, he's a real cunning linguist.
Cheeky basically tucked tail and trudged home after the Kane thing didn't work out. I can't imagine Pep is very happy.
Yeah, I'm kind of with him.
You're closer to John than say 100%
because
Pep
all summer was like, "Yeah, no, Kane would be. Please let me have Harry Kane, please. Could we please? Hi, hello, Harry Kane. I am interested. Would you like to? I will play you. Will you please come here, please? And
yeah, add.
Instead, our board was like, "You want him? We're gonna go get him. Here's 75. We want 150. Ah, shit. We gotta go."
Add us hitching our wagon to the Charlie Kane circus.
Yeah.
There's someone like that. Like, again.
Who?
Where's the judgment from the very top? Like, we are backing, you know, ideas and vibes, I guess, from like not trustworthy and serious people. Perez, right? Was the guy behind the Super League. The United guys were behind the Super League. Charlie Kane is not like even a real agent. Like, we're believing that he can get Harry Kane out of Spurs. He's going to get Harry Kane, who's on a 6-year deal with no release clause. Right. He's going to get Man City Harry Kane out of Daniel Levy's hands.
Yeah.
Right? Where there's no release clause.
Yeah.
All they've got is a gentleman's agreement. Why do we believe these jokers?
Right? Why do we keep doing gentleman's agreements, by the way?
Yeah. These guys are blaggers.
Yeah. Rank the, in terms of trustworthiness, rank the Canes. Charlie Kane or WWF Hall of Famer and kayfabe brother of The Undertaker, Kane.
Give me the very fake wrestling guy.
He can control fire?
As more believable than Charlie Kane.
All right. Well, that's pretty damning for Charles Kane. Rank the Canes. Charles Kane, Harry Kane, Miles Kane, and Kane.
Miles Kane.
Okay. Where's Citizen Kane?
Yeah. Well, we don't have one.
True. No, we have none.
Okay. Very last, Mike Frankish. Who do we prioritize for the next window? Who do you think we have a realistic chance of signing? So, all this being said, we've whiffed on our main target. There are still other strikers out there.
Yep. Yep.
Is all lost, or could there be some method to our madness here?
I mean, unless we like